Yeah, thanks very much. I'd like to start really by looking at the rise of UKIP, especially over the most recent period. I mean, UKIP obviously been around for a long time, but it was Marxism last year where we started to discuss really the threat that UKIP was posing, and we discussed that after the result of the European elections that took place last May, in which we saw UKIP top the polls and actually take, I think they actually have now 24 MEPs. I think they gained another 22 during that election. But really, where from that point, I mean, you know, when you think that was the first time in probably almost 100 years that any party other than the main three parties had actually topped the polls in an election in Britain. And of course, you know, we saw a real sort of, you know, a reshaping, if you like, of the political landscape of Britain. And of course, it was a discussion around a whole number of questions, which I'm going to go on to talk about in terms of the political crisis that was emerging within British politics as well. But the fact that we are now talking about the third largest party in Britain, and I think there has to be a remark made about this, because at the European elections last year, one of the things that we were able to celebrate at the time was the fact that we got rid of the British National Party MEPs of Nick Griffin and Andrew Bronz. I know he didn't re-stand. He didn't re-stand, I think, partly because of the testament of the campaign against him. But the fact that Nick Griffin was kicked out was a very good thing. And, of course, there's been a discussion over many years now as to, is Britain different to the rest of Europe, because the rest of Europe seems to have these sorts of racist parties. I'm going to go on to discussing stuff around Europe, but maybe Britain's different in some way, shape or form. And of course, we've always argued at the time that subjectively the difference we made through organisations like Unite Against Fascism was very important, but we've always said that the objective conditions actually for the growth of those type of parties as we've seen in Europe exists here. And of course, this is what we've seen really with the emergence of UKIP into British politics. The fact, though, that we do have a right-wing racist populist party as the third party in British politics is an incredibly worrying development, I think, for anybody on the left. In fact, any anti-racist across the UK, I think it's an incredibly worrying development. And, of course, following on from the European elections last year, where we saw them top the polls, we had the by-elections that were created by the defections of the two Tory MPs, Douglas Cardwell and Mark Reckless in Rochester, where, again, it was almost like you had this thing where there was this almost unstoppable thing of this UKIP sort of on the rise type of thing when they won those two by-elections. But, of course, both in the European elections and the by-elections, there was always arguments about, you know, they're different things, they're never quite going to be able to do that, and the general election, are they really a threat or not? And, of course, then when we saw the Heywood and Middleton by-election, where UKIP came second, and in actual fact were only 600 votes short of Labour's total there, then I think you started to see whole other sections of the Labour movement actually start to stand up and take notice, really, of the threat that UKIP were posing. Excuse me. And I think one of the things that we've always argued, really, is that the impact of UKIP is way beyond just their electoral gains. And I think that's absolutely obvious in terms of, you know, you have the by-elections that take place. It isn't just about the positions that they won. The level of influence that Farage was able to actually have and UKIP have on politics in terms of mainstream politics was that they pulled the political debate massively to the right. And this is still continuing. I mean, I'm going to go on to later to look at the shock and awe tactics that Farage uses during the election campaign. But the fact that, for example, there's a meeting happening now around the Charlie Hebdo murders that took place in Paris, Farage uses that at the time to talk about Muslims being a fifth column inside of this country. And then what do we see now coming from Cameron? Actually, what we see coming from Cameron, again, is that it's now a thought crime almost for any Muslim to think critically of the West or think critically of the British state or criticise the war. This is opening the door to these people becoming radicalised. In other words, really what takes place in politics is that Nigel Farage pushes the door open and David Cameron walks right through it. And tugging just behind him, unfortunately and ashamedly, is a Labour Party actually who the leadership of which has actually decided that their way of dealing with UKIP actually is not to challenge them head on, but actually to ape some of that racism at the same time. And I want to come back to that a little bit later. But therefore, what we have is a party that really has had a major influence, I would say, on a lot of the mainstream parties, where even though during the general election, I think it was a fantastic victory for us that Farage was not elected. I think that was a real achievement of the campaign, both nationally and in Thanet. I think that the general election has shown, with almost 4 million votes, that UKIP cannot be ignored in any way, shape or form. They are going to attempt to really build on everything they've gained so far. And I want to sort of look really at what type of party UKIP are, because the context of the growth of UKIP is really the context, the growth of the right across Europe. And I think that's a massively important thing that we have to look at, because, you see, the growth of the right has really taken three different forms across Europe. We've seen a sort of classic fascist-style parties, people like Jobbik, Golden Dawn, for example, the Euro-fascists like the Front National, and so on. We've also seen, of course, we have street movements like the English Defence League, the Polish fascists, the movements in Bulgaria that are now happening. There is a growth of the right, undoubtedly, across Europe. And of course, I think UKIP have to be placed within that context as well. But actually, really what I think UKIP are is I call it a right-wing racist populist party and not a fascist party, because I think it's very easy, and I think it is, you know, a common mistake that anything that is reactionary or racist and nasty, it must be a fascist organisation. I don't believe UKIP are a fascist organisation. I'm going to go on later to look at the origins of UKIP and where they have come from, but they are absolutely rooted within an attempt to use the democratic forms of parliament and so on, local authorities and so on, to take power. Of course, there's a bigger meeting, isn't it, discussion about what is fascism and what are fascist type organisations, but I don't believe they have the characteristics of a fascist style organisation. I mean, I think the emergence of the right-wing racist populist parties, the PVV, which is the Geert Wilders party in the Netherlands as well, plus UKIP, what you see, they have a number of things in common: anti-Europe, anti-immigration, racism, homophobia. I think they're also they're incredibly sexist parties as well. In fact, I think they want to push back the gains that have been made for women and for gay people, without a doubt. And that most definitely characterises them. There is an incredibly worrying development, I believe. I mean, people will have seen recently that within the European Parliament that we've seen the formation of the Europe of Nations and Freedoms group. I don't know if people have seen that or not, but Janice Atkinson, who was the MEP for UKIP down in Folkestone, who was expelled over... She wasn't expelled for calling a Thai woman a ting-tong, by the way. They'll accept, of course, that level of racism within the organisation. She wasn't expelled, but she was actually expelled really for an expenses scandal, which was a sting by the press. But what Janice Atkinson has done is joined the group with PVV, with the Front National and so on, and there's these different Polish organisations involved in it. They needed seven countries, which is what you have to have in terms of forming a group to gain access to funding. And Janice Atkinson, being expelled from UKIP and then joining them, has given them the seventh country they need in order to access a sum of funding from the European Parliament. And I think that's incredibly worrying development. And of course, as well, you know, it represents, I think, a shift as well for the PVV, for example, which is the Geert Wilders party, because they have really moved to the right in terms, they've always said they wouldn't ally themselves with the Front National. Now they have done, really, for the Front National. This is a further attempt to de-demonise themselves, if you like, as not being called fascist, not being able to be labelled in that way. And the fact the right wing's in a position to do that, I think, is a real issue and a challenge for the left. But one of the things I want to argue is that all of these parties have grown off the back of three things. And the first thing is, of course, is racism. Because, you know, actually, in truth, it's not UKIP that have created the racism within the debate. They have grown off the back of the racism that has been peddled and pushed by the other mainstream parties. They absolutely further it now. They absolutely use it. So there's a dynamic taking place where actually they're constantly pushing a very racist agenda inside of British politics. But I think we have to say that in terms of the levels of racism that exists, you know, when we think about... No, racism hasn't, and immigration hasn't always been a feature of our elections, actually. I mean, you go back to the Blair's election in 1997, immigration just wasn't even mentioned, actually, at that time at all. And I think, you know, the emergence of that into British politics is something interesting to look at in terms of the way in which actually asylum seekers started to become attacked. Then, of course, the major impact, of course, of the Iraq war in terms of, you know, using that as a, using the demonisation of Muslims, the rise of Islamophobia, as a way of attempting to justify the war abroad, and an attack that is still ongoing and actually is deepening and I believe is getting worse in terms of those. I mean, you only have to think last year of the Trojan horse scandal that happened inside of Birmingham. You look now at the way the prevent strategy that is taking place inside of educational establishment that's going to be pushed into the public sector, for nearly all public servants have to be on the lookout for extremism and so on. In other words, constantly this idea of the enemy within is the notion of it. And like I say, it's got echoes, of course, of Farage's fifth column absolutely running all the way through it. But the levels of racism that exist, and of course here we see it characterised in terms of Islamophobia. Actually, when you go to different parts of Eastern Europe, you will see the attacks on the Roma are astronomical. It is unbelievable what's taking place, the level of persecution against the Roma. The anti-Semitism that we see, for example, in Hungary, Jobbik is a real classic example of that, of a real push around anti-Semitism. So the racism takes different forms according to different countries that you go to, but nevertheless, the rise in racism has been a real key part of providing the fertile ground on which these people can grow. The second thing, I think, which has had a major influence over it has been the economic crisis. And of course, you know, we all know the 1930s scream out at us in times of economic crisis, the necessity of a scapegoat for the ruling class in terms of avoiding for paying for their own crisis. Their question always is, who's going to pay for this? Certainly at the moment, it's not them that's paying for the crisis. Certainly it's us. And one of the key weapons, of course, in their armoury around that is racism. And of course, one of the most blatant examples of that would be around health tourism. It's absolutely clear what has really destroyed massive parts of the NHS has been privatisation, has been cuts in funding, but actually really what the politicians want to push on about is health tourism. And of course you can see therefore the real role the economic crisis has had, austerity, the sense of desperation that people feel about it, actually I think has also fueled the growth of the far right. And of course the third thing I think that has done that has also been a level of political crisis that's taken place. And of course, people have witnessed that in terms of, you know, the fact that we have, you know, in the last election, for example, the winning party, the Tory party, 24% of the electorate vote for them, 25% of the electorate vote for parties different to the main three parties. There is a change in the political landscape that is taking place. There's a democratic deficit in terms of people feeling represented. And of course, I think it really emerged in the UK around the time of the expenses scandal. It was the final nail in the coffin, if you like, for the idea that the MPs are anything to do with or any understanding of our lives, that they're not corrupt, that they're not all in this together. And of course, throughout that process, what Farage and UKIP have done is attempted to pose themselves as the anti-establishment party, that they are not like, you know, they've talked a lot about the political class is how they deem it. And in actual fact, their opportunity really knows no bounds, because now really what they're attempting to claim, of course, is that the Greek vote of no actually is something which they would like to say, we back the Greek people in doing this. Their opportunism, I think, will, you know, and in terms of their sense of trying to portray themselves as anti-establishment, I want to go on to this later, but I think it's going to be a key part of their strategy during the EU referendum as well. And so I think all of those three things, racism, economic crisis and political crisis, have created the fertile ground on which the right have grown. And I think it's important to then think about actually, you know, when we try and tackle UKIP and when we're trying to tackle organisations of the right, I think it is important to look at where they've come from, and especially when it comes to UKIP, in the sense of undermining really notions or ideas that this is an anti-establishment party. Because one of the key things of their strategy, they've called it their 2020 strategy, is they want to go for the northern heartlands of Labour. Really, this is where they are aiming their fire at that. And the idea that they are a party of workers or a party of anti-establishment, I think, is something that we have to get rid of. And the origins of UKIP, I think, show that as well. Because around the early 1990s, I think probably 1990, when the Maastricht Treaty was signed, this is going to become so much more commonplace now, is it, that we talk about stuff around Europe, because this referendum thing is going to obviously really build. And I know there's a meeting tomorrow on the European referendum as well. But the European Union obviously was formed after the Second World War, but it was in the early 1990 when you saw, in fact, following on from the revolutions and breakup of the Soviet bloc in 1989, where you saw the Maastricht Treaty being signed. And the Maastricht Treaty was the thing that really ushered in greater economic and political union and the euro, in fact, for some countries who subscribed to taking that on as their currency. And it was around that time. In actual fact, it's not just the case that UKIP formed at that time. The divisions inside the Tory party at the time, people who were around at the time may remember, it plagued John Major's government massively. You know, this whole thing around divisions around Europe, and it has never left the Tory party. We still have 50-odd MPs or whatever it is inside the Tory party around John Redwood and that, who formed their opposition to the European Union and so on. And I want to sort of look at why that was, really. Because, you see, the truth of it is that the debate that took place around the European Union, I think really is a representative of different interests amongst the British ruling class. And one of the reasons why I say that is because I think it's important to look at the development of British trade and so on. But really, what you start to see when the push for the European Union came is a section of the British capitalist class whose trade links, and this has always been a debate about whether you lump your lot in with America, whether you go with the Europeans and so on, whose trade links that lay outside of the European Union. And the divisions that have occurred, I mean, there's been the referendum party that was set up by Goldsmith. People remember Goldsmith, who stood and they started it. UKIP started out as the Anti-Federalist League, then it went on to become UKIP. Don't people remember Robert Kilroy Silk? Yeah, so you forget sometimes how long these people have been around, because they felt like such a bloody irrelevance for such a long period of time. But of course, they have gone through different periods in their own political development. But really, what took place is you had a formation of UKIP on the basis, and the material reality of which was that you had different sections of the British ruling class felt their economic interest laid in different areas. The truth is, though, is that over the period of time, really what they have done is they have, and I think Farage actually has played a key part of this in both times that he's led UKIP. He's led it on two separate occasions. Both times, the reason why, I think, is because Farage actually looked at the emergence of the racist populist parties across Europe and actually pushed for the UKIP to become more than just a single issue party on the question of the European Union. And he learnt, really, I think, off the racist populist parties across Europe in terms of actually how he tried to put that into place. And so, really, what you see is that, and I think really it was their approach to the European elections really characterises for me, in a nutshell, really how UKIP are almost, which is that at the time that Farage was doing his Talking Sense tour, the people remember that, you might not have seen it, because he went out to these places, the towns and cities in Suffolk, in Essex, in some of the port areas down places like Lowestoft and then places like Peterborough. And on his Talking Sense tour, of course, what Farage talks about are the ghettos that are developing in Britain. You know, the worries and the concerns he has about not being able to hear English being spoken until he moves on a train that goes so far out of London and so on. It's this populist racism that he rams home. At the same time as Farage is delivering his Talking Sense tour, we have Stuart Wheeler, who is actually one of the richest men in Britain, who moved from the Tory party into UKIP. A lot of them actually came from that ultra-Thatcherite Tory section, Thatcherite section of the Tory party. But he, who was actually in the city gathering industrialists, financiers, bankers together and so on, holding meetings in the city of London, in which he doesn't talk about ghettos in the UK. That is not how Stuart Wheeler addresses financiers and bankers. Really what he talks about is the economic case against Europe. Yeah, why we have to be able to trade without the restrictions of the European Union. So these people are absolutely fundamentally a part of the British establishment, a part of the British ruling class, and actually their currency that they use amongst people actually is a populist racism. And I think that really characterises and sums them up. And I think we have to expose their, how much a part of the establishment these people are. I suppose really the next question that comes out of that then in terms of their approach towards politics is also about who votes for UKIP. Because clearly they have 4 million votes. I think it's almost works out, I think it's like 12.6% I think it was in their total vote in the election. And it's almost, it's been some of a, what of a contentious issue at times, I suppose, because people are sort of attempting to claim that, well, UKIP certainly are claiming they're becoming the party of the working class. And of course, their aim is on the Labour heartlands. But let's look at where their vote comes from, because actually 43% of their vote were ex-Tory voters. Okay, and that is important to acknowledge that. It doesn't mean they weren't working class, by the way, because actually there's always been a section of the working class that has voted Tory. You know, there is an uneven and contradictory consciousness amongst the working class, undoubtedly true. 43% were Tory voters. 19% voted UKIP last time. 18% were from the Lib Dems. And then 14% from Labour. So the notion, the idea that they are taking massive votes off Labour, I don't think is right. I don't think that's the right way to characterise it. But that doesn't mean that we don't have an issue in terms of how we deal with this. Because, you see, when you think about the fact that that UKIP, not just the 4 million votes, that came first, obviously, only in Clacton, but they came second in 120 seats across the UK. And that's pretty important, really. And actually, when you think about some of the places where they came second, Heywood and Middleton in Manchester, Rotherham, Dagenham, Rother Valley, Hartlepool, West Bromwich West, Wentworth and Dern around Barnsley, Doncaster Central, Bolton South East, Barnsley East. So the top 20 places they came second are evenly split between Tory and between Labour, actually, as well, in that sense. But clearly, they are knocking on the door in a whole number of these places. I mean, it's interesting in the sense of inside the New Statesman. You know, they talk about, they look at some of the analysis across the North, and they look, for example, where in seats that were Tory held before the election, the UKIP averaged 12.5% in the vote. Seats where Labour held before, UKIP averaged 16.9% in those areas as well. What I do think is also important, though, as a counteraction to that, is that actually Labour's vote also went up in a whole number of the places where UKIP comes second and where UKIP votes go up. In other words, there is a conscious section of the working class that actually is totally opposed to UKIP on ideological grounds and so on as well. And I think that is an important factor for us. Because actually, when you think about how we stop these people, clearly their 2020 strategy for breaking into the Labour heartlands is something. These are places where we have to be amongst the trade unionists in the area, amongst Labour Party members in the area, anti-racists. We have to pull those people together actually in a coalition that does stand up to UKIP. And that's obviously the case of what we've done in a whole number of places where actually we've damaged their votes in a whole number of ways. The Harlow comrades, actually be really interesting to hear from them actually, because they've done some serious damage to UKIP inside of Harlow by actually pulling together precisely those sorts of people in a coalition that is able to do that. And so really, I think the ways in which UKIP campaign give us an indication as to how we actually stop them. Because, you see, when you think about what the different approaches have been towards them, is that I've already talked about the fact that we've seen Labour aping and moving to the right over it. The immigration controls mug is a notorious symbol of the election campaign. Clearly, we have to take on UKIP's racism. I don't think there's any question over that. I think it is a mistake, and I think Labour made the mistake of, on the front of their leaflet, they attack UKIP over the question of the National Health Service. Good, you should absolutely do that. On the back of the leaflet, they talk about being harder and stronger on immigration. I mean, let's be clear, you are never going to out-UKIP UKIP. It's never going to happen. Neither the Tory party nor the Labour, they are not going to outdo these people in terms of their levels of racism and what they're prepared to say. So we absolutely have to take them on that question. The other thing, of course, that's important is that if you look back to Farage and UKIP's thoughts about this, in internal minutes that we see leaked from UKIP in 2013, one of the things which they were clear about was that their Achilles heel was racism. And that actually for them to have that label around them is incredibly damaging for them to have that. So I think that is a very important factor that we have to take on. And we have to take it on a number of grounds. Firstly, I think we must take it on a principle ground. You know, we have to take this on because we know the damage and the division that racism creates amongst our communities. It's a principled thing, I think, for any trade union socialist to do has to be to take on their racism, and tactically it's also massively important. But it isn't enough just to take on their racism. We have to take on the fact that they are a neoliberal Thatcherite party that wants to damage working class people, because obviously they are looking to hold some type of audience amongst those people as well. And so therefore I think, again, the question of the united front, I mean, you know, we talk about this in terms of dealing with fascism and so on. I actually think we have to have similar formations when we're talking about dealing with UKIP, you know. And, you know, I mean, you think about actually let me just find my quote. I mean, I've got a quote here from Trotsky about the United Front, where he basically says, the United Front tactic is simply an initiative whereby communists propose to join with all workers belonging to other political parties and groups and unaligned workers in a common struggle to defend the immediate basic interests of the working class against the bourgeoisie. Every action for even the most trivial everyday demands can lead to revolutionary awareness and revolutionary education. It's the experience of struggle that will convince workers inevitably of revolution and the historic importance of communism. But the tactic of the United Front, of actually pulling together and uniting with people from various different backgrounds, and I think it's important therefore that Stand Up to UKIP never took a position of who people should vote for in the election. We were very clear about that because we had people from Labour Party backgrounds, Green backgrounds, Tusk members and so on who are a part of that, and it's a real key thing, I think, that we make sure that we unite people on those grounds in terms of taking them forward. The other thing I think as well is important is that we absolutely, the struggle that takes place against austerity now over the next few years, I think will also have a major impact on what happens. Because actually, when you think about every time you see people standing up and fighting back, striking, massive demonstrations against austerity, UKIP are nowhere to be seen. Nowhere to be seen, actually. On the People's Assembly demonstration of 250,000 that marched through London, they're nowhere. They did actually try and go on Gay Pride the week after, actually. But they don't take part in anything, actually, that comes up against austerity and against the cuts and so on that are taking place. And I think it's important that we have a focus on that as well, because that movement, I think, is going to be a key part, actually, for all workers across the country in terms of standing up and fighting back. The other thing, of course, is that we have to have a long-term strategy in both their terms of their long-term, both nationally and locally. And, of course, it depends where you are. You know, if you're in Thanet, where UKIP have just won control of the council, keeping an eye and monitoring actually what UKIP do on that council, exposing when they vote for cuts, exposing when they push things like that, is a very, very important thing for us to do. I think also where people, you know, the local elections next year, actually UKIP again are going to really push themselves forward in those local elections. Inside the EU referendum, we have to take a position, I think, is that we want racism out of the referendum. Yeah, that's what we want. We want it out. And also, I think we have to undermine the idea that these people can have any claim to the Oki vote inside of Greece as well. I don't think the left can leave that terrain actually to the right wing inside of that debate. In terms of Stand Up after UKIP campaign, however, I don't think we can take a position of yes or no around this referendum. I think our position has to be is we are against racism and we are against the neoliberal policies of the bankers, which actually UKIP are very, very closely aligned to. I think we have to take them on both of those grounds. And I think on top of that, you know, we have to be clear that the disaffection that actually can spurn the growth of these types of parties is also the same disaffection that can spurn the growth of parties like Syriza as well. You know, we don't see the emergence of that so much inside of the UK, and that's why I think the anti-austerity struggles are massively important. But I think we have to take them on a principle ground, attack actually the fact that they're attacking working class people. And I think if you're a socialist at the same time, you have to be fighting to see a political alternative out there that can actually take on all of the main establishment parties, including UKIP, and call them out on their neoliberal and racist policies.
Hi everyone, my name's Jen. I'm from Sheffield Socialist Worker Party branch and also co-organised Sheffield Disabled People Against the Cuts, which as well as being an anti-cuts organisation, are also an anti-fascist organisation. When you're listening to meetings like this where we're talking about how we challenge the what seems to be the rapidly growing success of a party like UKIP, it can seem very, very daunting and it can seem very, very difficult because they've got so much money behind them and so much education behind these people as well, a lot more than someone like me who's a single mum off a council estate in Sheffield. But two things I want to talk about, a little bit of success, two success stories. One, we had a scrap work capability assessments demonstration outside the DWP office in Sheffield, co-organised with DPAC and the local UNAT community. Now, as we're having this demonstration, one of the people that was a service user that's going into the building shouts, "Vote UKIP!" Right? We actually had someone speaking at the time and I had to say, sorry, I'm going to have to stop you there. So I'm going to answer what this gentleman's just said, right? At this demonstration, we've got Tusk speaking, we've got Labour speaking, we've got the Green Party, we've got the Bakers Union, we've got the TUC, United Community, DPAC. Where's your people's party now? Right? And I tell you where they are. They're in an office somewhere, they don't give a stuff about you, they don't give a stuff about me. And when you come back out of that door, because you've lost everything, you've lost absolutely everything because you failed some little tick box system that says you are actually able to go and work, despite what your GP and anyone else knows you says. We'll still be here. We will be here for you whenever you need us, okay? And I'm pretty sure that gave him something to think about. He soon shut up. Secondly, second success story, and so I'll keep it brief, is that I don't know how many of you know that fairly recently we had a South Yorkshire PCC election in South Yorkshire, and basically it was a two-horse race between the Labour Party candidate and a UKIP candidate. Now, as Joe said, we stand up to UKIP and other anti-UKIP organisations. We don't tell people who we think they should vote for, but exposing the truth behind UKIP. Now, I'll tell you something now, when a lot of those ex-Orgreave miners found out that the UKIP candidate, John Clarkson, had actually been a uniformed police officer at the time of the miners' strike, we soon found that Alan Billings of the Labour Party won the PCC. Now, I couldn't particularly give a crap about the fact that he won. But that is a 100% success story because we exposed the truth behind them, who they really are. And that's what we need to do, to pull down the drapes that they're putting up. Every single one of us. We can do it. It does work. And we need to do it together.
Hi, it's John Flagg from Thanet Stand Up to UKIP. Now, first thing I want to say is that when Farage didn't win the seat in Thanet, it wasn't simply because he failed to win it, as the BBC might say. He was actually beaten. And it was a massive campaign of local people supported by people from the outside that drove... It was a small mass movement, but it was a mass movement of local people doing all sorts of activities. And it was around a very central question, which was stop Farage. We didn't manage to stop UKIP totally. We didn't manage to win every argument, but people got this idea in their head that we can collectively act to stop this man winning. And I think you only have to think of what the damage would have been had he won. Can you imagine now the platform Farage would have had he been an MP, and how that would play in the next year through the referendum and the rest of it. So I think it was a fantastic victory for Stand Up to UKIP nationally and Stand Up to UKIP locally to stop him. And actually, you know, two of the highlights of the campaign down there was the large march in Margate to the spring conference of UKIP, where hundreds of people came down and joined hundreds of people in Thanet, and it was the biggest march the locals have ever seen. It, you know, never had that size march in a seaside town like that before, so it was massive. And also the weekend before the actual vote, people came down to help us canvass, and we took over and dominated the town centre on that weekend. And all sorts of people have come up to say the fact that you took that ground was key to demoralising UKIP. And we know that because in the last week, Farage did over 20 meetings in a small town. Imagine every ward he did massive meetings. Every meeting he stood up and he said, "You might have seen that rabble in the town centre." Da, 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 da. So we got under his skin. We turned him into that snarling, beastly face that they started to complain about. And the campaign was big. I assessed that there was something like 500 people involved locally in the campaign, one extreme or another, and there was a core of around 50, I would say. And those 50 are still meeting and they're still doing stuff. We turned Farage from an asset into a liability locally, and I think he's becoming a liability to them nationally. That's why the splits are happening. UKIP took the council. We've got a team of people looking at the council, going to every meeting, noting things down, etc. Quickly, we've got to get a campaign to knock racism out of the referendum. Vote yes or no, but say, you know, knock racism out. And we need to start pulling that united front together now. I think it is eminently possible. I can see it forming, Thanet, that we can do that. And we've got to do that nationally.
Can I just ask people to keep their hands up, because quite a lot have gone up and it's difficult for me to keep a check on them. And if people can keep to time, please. So this speaker will be followed by someone over here.
Jeremy Guise from Plymouth SWP. I wanted to say something about the Stand Up to UKIP campaign, because it's a united front, as Joe says, and we've tried to include in Plymouth other people and other than the SWP and get other people involved with it. I have to say, it's still something which we're working on. There's a long legacy of Unite Against Fascism, and many people will have been involved in that as a united front, and that legacy means that there is a group of activists who can be called upon. When the BNP were doing demonstrations and we had about 40 or 50 people we can call upon to be fairly sure that we're going to get those people. And and they cover a spectrum from Labour Party, Green Party and all sorts of other people, which we can get for UAF. Stand Up to UKIP hasn't quite got that resonance yet, and I think there's still quite a lot of convincing to do with other parts of the left and other anti-racists that this is something that they actively need to campaign against. There is a perception that UKIP are just another right-wing party and that they don't need challenging in the same way. So I do think we've got to do that. And I think it's particularly important with the referendum coming up, because we're going to see, if we're not very careful, the UKIP agenda and the Tory Eurosceptic agenda being the dominant one. And I think those who are going to be arguing against the EU from a left position are going to have to work very hard to make sure that the reasons why we're opposing Europe and the European institutions from a left-wing perspective are clear to people. Thank you.
Okay, the speaker will be followed by the man in the glasses.
Hi, I'm Caroline from Stand Up to UKIP in Manchester. I just want to talk a little bit about our campaign in Harold and Middleton, and also there was a successful campaign in Wigan as well, in Greater Manchester, where they were, that was the two target seats in the North West, and UKIP didn't win either of those seats. Unfortunately, though, they do now have two councillors in Darwin, in Blackburn. I think what was important in the campaign was to go out and to speak to people and to say what UKIP were about. I think the literature was really helpful, the exposing UKIP, the seven myths about UKIP, so that we could say actually this is what they're about. Because if you read their literature, it says they're pro-NHS, it doesn't say anything about racism, you know, it says it wants to help local services. It is just lies, just total lies. So what we had to do was have some hard arguments. It wasn't easy. It was, you know, we did come across a lot of racism. They don't pick areas. The Haywood and Middleton is a really quite run-down area. It's been a split between Labour and the Lib Dems in recent elections. The Labour MP, who was elected only a few months previously in a by-election, was quite supportive of our campaign because she knew the danger. She knew she only had a 600 majority at the by-election. And we went every 2 weeks. We were swapping between the two towns because they are slightly separate. And we also engaged with local people, and we did manage to get other people involved in the campaign. What we did find difficult, which I think the gentleman before was saying, was creating a united front on this campaign. We had a great launch meeting, which Unison spoke at, and a local refugee organisation spoke at, but we couldn't bring that into support on the streets or support on the financially. So it was down to stand up to UKIP and local anti-racists. But we fought the campaign well. It really upsets them when you call them racist. They hate it, and they do say, if you're calling UKIP racist, you're calling me a racist if I vote for them. And I didn't say yes. I didn't say yes, we are. But I did say, well, why would you want to vote for a racist? Why do you want to vote for racist politicians? Why do you want to vote for John Bickley, who is clearly racist, and he'd already stood once in Manchester for UKIP? If you're not racist, then vote for somebody else, and then we won't call you racist. But the argument was hard. We did get abused. There was a lady with us who was really badly racially abused. But we have to get out there. We have to have that argument. They aren't for us. They are for the elite. They don't stand hand in hand with the Greek people. We stand hand in hand with the Greek people. We need to fight. We need to get these racists out of our towns, and we need to fight for a revolution in Greece and fight for a revolution here.
Yeah, I want to really emphasise just how dangerous UKIP are because of the way they've made racism respectable. I think that's very important. But also that they can be pushed back. They don't have it all their own way. And I'm going to be talking about Rotherham, which is, you know, one of those heartlands that UKIP have set the targets on because of all the ingredients that Joe's outlined, you know, the racism, the economic crisis and the political crisis. Labour has been in total meltdown in Rotherham for quite some time, but also been hit by, I'm sure people know, the huge child sex exploitation scandal. Which has created an opportunity for the racists. And I think really you can say that although Rotherham has been hit by virtually every fascist group from Britain in the last year, in fact, we've got the EDL again next Saturday, Britain First on September the 5th. I mean, this just goes on and on. We have turned the tide. We have united people against the racists. They haven't divided us. We've made it clear that we stand for justice for the victims of child sex abuse, but don't let the racists divide us. That has stood us in good stead because it's created an atmosphere which has now begun to turn the tide and change things. But we do have a problem with UKIP. But as I say, they don't have it all their own way. Jen mentioned the police commissioner election, but also in the election in Rotherham. They were expected in the general election, they came second, which was too close for comfort. But actually, Labour's vote did go up, so people did turn out against them. And also in the council elections, they only won three seats, one from the Tories and two from Labour. And they didn't make any other gains. The previous May, they won 10 seats. So you can see the pictures that, yes, UKIP are definitely the beneficiaries of the racism that's being whipped up in Rotherham, which is part of the general Islamophobia and the attacks on Muslims everywhere else, but they can be pushed back. And with some of the things we've done have shown that, because we had a protest when Farage came to open an office in Rotherham, the first time really that there'd been any opposition to UKIP in the town, and that made a big difference. That turned the tide, because people started to think, well, who are these racists? Who are these people that want to attack the health service? But I do think we have to be clear that their racism is anti-working class every bit as much as their attacks on the health service and supporting the bankers and all the rest of it. So we can't dodge that one. We have to take on the racism. But I think if we can build those united fronts, we've still got to build unite against fascism. But I think also, stand up to UKIP, we've got a lot more work to do, because next May, as well as it may be the EU referendum, the whole of the council is up for election in Rotherham, and that's going to be a serious challenge to us. And it really is vital that we're seeing a new spirit of resistance that's developing. We link the fight against racism to the fight against austerity. If we do that, we can beat them. Let's all go to TUC demo in October. Thanks.
I was a Tusk candidate in Tottenham in the general election, and we were facing a UKIP candidate, a black election agent, an Asian UKIP candidate, and their arguments were very much that it's new migrants to blame. It's these people coming in, taking our houses, lowering our wages. And we had to take those arguments head on the street in Tottenham. And once we put the clear arguments that, look, there's 70,000 empty homes in London, the problem is that it's the rich buying them for investment, not to live in. Wages have gone up for the ruling class people, but they've gone down for us. We're facing the longest decline in real wages since the 1870s. When we put the clear argument to blame the bosses, not the arguments, not the migrants, we were winning those arguments. The problem was there's not enough of us. And the problem also is that arguments in themselves are no substitute for struggle. The height of the anti-austerity struggle was in 2011, when we saw 2.6 million workers on the street, the biggest public sector strike since the general strike. And that march was really distinctive, because it was the majority of participants were women, and there was a significant proportion of black and minority ethnic people. That's the key. It's unity in struggle. We've got to take on the arguments that it's the bosses to blame, not the migrants. And if we can go forward to defeat austerity, anti-racism has got to be central to that.
Thanks. Followed by that comrade there.
Okay, comrades, greetings from Greece, from the campaigners of No. And because I have just 2 minutes, I would say that it's very important how you stand in the referendum for European Union. Because what we did in Greece was to combine the fight against austerity with the fight against racism. One day before the referendum, there was a mass workers' strike in Marathon, peasant workers revolting against the racism and against their bosses. So we produced a sticker that said no to Europe of racism and austerity. The bosses support, yes. What do you support was the question. So we were there. We know that the Syriza government that was under pressure to call this referendum is cooperating with the independent party, which is a party like UKIP. So we had mass demonstrations, and the way to keep that these demonstrations are against austerity and against racism is for you to be there. So we didn't hesitate that Syriza is on government, so the revolutionaries should abstain. This is what the Communist Party of Greece did, and it was a big mistake. So we were there organizing the workplaces, organizing the unity of the workers to fight for no, but the no was very clear that we say no to austerity, no to racism. And the same week, we had the independent party, in the same coalition government with Syriza, voting against the right for children for citizenship. I mean, the Syriza government, under pressure, pushed for a new bill to give a citizenship for the children. Not to all of them. That's why we argued that we need more. But this party was absolutely against. So we had also a campaign on the same time in the trade unions, in the teachers' unions, where we got this vote on a united front basis with the Social Democrats, with Syriza, with the Communist Party members and so on. So we have to be very clear that in the period of crisis and the huge political crisis, the fight against racism should be also a political fight connected with the working class, with the left, and pushing for an anti-capitalist solution. This is creating hope, and you can win all the people for a no, which is opening the way for also for anti-capitalist solutions.
Thank you. This comrade will be followed by the woman sat in the red there.
Yeah, I just wanted to quickly say, because, I mean, anyone who saw 4 million votes for UKIP, you'd wonder how much success the Sutu campaign had. So I'm glad Comrade spoke about the local victories that they did have. You know, John spoke about Thanet. In Dudley North, at one stage, UKIP were down to win that seat. We also had, just before the election, the Tory candidate there colluding with a bloody EDL and eventually goes. So you'd think it was a perfect seat for UKIP. Our comrades in the local Stamps UKIP group there delivered 20,000 leaflets, and UKIP got knocked back to third. Joe mentioned Harlow. UKIP lost two councillors there, and again, their candidate there finished third. And in Great Yarmouth as well, another seat a while ago, UKIP were looking to win. They didn't. So there was some modest victories. But I understand completely when comrades talk about the difficulties of building a united front, and it relates to the things that Joe's talking about. UKIP aren't a fascist organisation, so it's harder for people, particularly if they're in political parties, to get them to come along to the campaign, particularly if their own parties and candidates are pushing racism. But we have to absolutely redouble our efforts to push for United Front. If anyone saw Denmark recently, a racist populist party actually won the election there, and this is what happens when you don't challenge parties like UKIP. So I'd be absolutely clear, you know, like Joe and others said, I think we're entering a positive time in the sense of the anti-austerity movement. It's crucial, and it'll be very difficult for parties like UKIP to do well when the struggle is on the rise. When we see strikes like the RMT, that black and white workers stand together in struggle, it's very, very difficult for them to do well. But we can't be complacent about that as well. So I agree, we've taken the model of Petros, really, an anti-austerity movement that absolutely says no to austerity and no to racism is what we need in this country.
Okay, and this speaker will be followed by the speaker at the front, will be the last one in this debate.
What I'd like to talk about is the media sort of collusion that led to UKIP's sort of rise. The idea, they've got this idea that we're not racist. This is their tagline, we're not racist. This allows racists to deny who they are, what they stand for, because if it's immigrants, it's not racist, because, you know, we're not focusing on their skin colour. We're focusing on the fact that they come from different countries. The Rise in Britain First photos on the internet. I've known someone recently on my Facebook profile who's shared something which is supposed to be a nostalgic post about the past, but which includes the line when the hold on immigration was greater. And she's from an Irish background, who her mother was an immigrant. You know, it's shocking what these people are getting away with by putting these things out there, this propaganda, which is allowing people to get sucked in. Because if someone likes that post, then they'll go on to more things from Britain First, and they'll start thinking in this sort of vein. Also, the decline in political satire has helped with parties to raise their sort of their ideology. If we're not making jokes about the BNP and UKIP, we're not attacking them in their ideologies. If we can't joke about them, we have to take them seriously. And so the BBC have played a huge part in this by their inclusivity of all the parties and in debate. You know, Nigel Farage was allowed on Have I Got News For You a few years ago. Don't know if anyone remembers that. No one knew what he stood for back then, and that was dangerous. You know, I was looking at this guy. I didn't know what he stood for. What is this party about? Are they left? Are they right? No one knows. And also, this is not just something that UKIP used. During David Cameron's first reign as Prime Minister, he appeared on MasterChef. Now, he appeared as a very smiley character. He had a suit on, he had his hair done very nice. He didn't seem very horrible. He didn't mention, you know, anything about politics. They were talking about, do you have spaghetti carbonara for dinner? Does your wife
cook? Can I ask you to finish them, please? Yeah,
that's basically it. It's used by all parties, really. So we should just be aware of it.
Joe did an excellent talk, and what I want to argue is that we're in a race against time in terms of who shapes what, because the first thing we won was the argument that UKIP couldn't easily join with the Front National. There's a reason why UKIP are nervous about joining with the Front National. That's because we pushed them back over the Nazis. But there's nothing static about this situation. The high vote that they've got is an attempt to shift things. Think about Enoch Powell. When Enoch Powell stood, he got kicked out and ended up somewhere in Northern Ireland. Imagine if Enoch Powell had a party. That's what UKIP represent. It's not just that they've won. They begin to shape the political nature of what racism is saying. They begin to allow the unacceptable to become acceptable. I'm not racist, I'm just saying racist things. And that argument actually begins to have a problem at the base of our society. It's part of the reasons why the unions have ducked the question over stand up to UKIP. You see, when you do UAF, they say, yes, we should stand up against the fascist. When we do UKIP, they say, but are you just calling people racist who've got genuine concerns? And I keep saying, we have got genuine concerns. We want more housing. We want more of those things that are against it. But actually, the scapegoating politics has to be challenged. And that makes it a much more complicated question about how we fight. We're going to have to fight on many different fronts. It's important that we don't call them Nazis. We have a strategy for dealing with that. But they will build a space that enables Nazis to build and come back in a much more vicious way. The question that Petros raised, when you look at Greece and you see the general strikes and you see the struggle, you see the future in two ways. You see the alternative of people beginning to fight. But that's not just the end of the alternative. It is a space that I think we're building up to about why we have to have both stand up to UKIP, the different united fronts, and we're going to have to mobilise deeply in the way that they talked about inside Rotherham and move very, very fast, because the atmosphere in Britain is beginning to change. But it doesn't mean it's inevitable, but we are in that struggle now, and it's a struggle that we can win because we can look at the traditions of how we've fought in the past. I'll stop there.
Okay, so thank you very much, everyone. And I'm going to ask Joe to come back and sum up and answer the questions.
Great, thank you. Yeah, and thanks for all the contributions. I mean, I'll just start with, I'm trying to run through and just respond to some people about things. I mean, to Jen and the comrades in DPAC, I mean, DPAC, I think, have been a fantastic part of the Stand Up to UKIP campaign, actually. I mean, out in Bromley as well. Paula Peters out there has been a great asset to Stand Up to UKIP, and they've really taken part and are part of the Stand Up to UKIP National Steering Committee as well. I think because they're only too aware, actually, of UKIP's policies and also their approach towards disability within society as well. And I think there's a whole number of areas that they are backwards on, and I think we should be clear about that, because one of the things as well is that, let's not forget their opposition to gay marriage as well. Now, clearly, that has been a tactical question for Farage in terms of attempting to peel off sections of the Tory party, but it's to represent still a force of reaction. And it's a force of reaction we can't afford to ignore, because when you think about the fact that inside of France, what you have is almost 500,000 people marching for the family against gay marriage, that they are tying up with, you know, ultra-nationalist right-wing Catholic groups, up with fascist organisations and racists and so on. These people are attempting to push back, really, the gains that have been made for the LGBT community, people with disabilities, for women. They're really trying to push those things back. They absolutely represent the forces of reaction inside of society, and I think we should be clear of that. I think also it's interesting to listen to people talking from Manchester about the campaign, because one of the things which UKIP have done, actually, is picked up on the BNP vote, isn't it? And you think of those parts of the north where the BNP had about a 5% vote base there. UKIP have most definitely taken that, and they've made overtures towards the right because they wanted to get that vote. That was a clear tactical thing for them to do in terms of trying to harness a solid basis for their campaigns and so on. What I think is interesting
interesting about Hayward and Middleton as well, though, is that the turnout actually went up. The vote for Labour also went up at that point. And the type of campaigns that people have been involved in and engaged in, I think actually have raised the levels of participation that people have taken in terms of taking part in stopping UKIP as well. And that was definitely a part of the Thanet campaign. I also think, you know, the work that people talk about, you know, the work in Harlow, where you talk to some of the Labour councillors there who deliver 17,000 leaflets through people's doors inside of Harlow, they actually reduced the UKIP vote. UKIP lost councillors there. It goes against the trend of where they were going to, and it does show subjectively that locally people can make a difference. Actually, part of the trades, it was the Trades Council that is involved in that, Labour MP, local councillors and so on involved in that. It is possible to build these united fronts, but I think people have to go at them from a local angle at the moment, because it seems to me that the arguments that exist within the Labour Party about how to respond to UKIP actually become reflected inside the trade union movement is the truth of what takes place. And there's all sorts of different arguments in there. I mean, don't forget that during the election campaign, Tony Blair put forward a pro-immigration argument. He put forward the capitalist argument for why you have to have free movement of labour because it's important for business. Yeah. Then you have sections of the Labour Party who follow the Goodwin and Ford theory that actually these are the disaffected whites and we have to move towards them by moving towards and accepting that they have some genuine concerns about immigration and so on and so forth. Then you have people like Diane Abbott and so on who are attempting to say, don't play towards the racist, you can't out UKIP, UKIP. So there's a wide range. And actually it's really made them almost a little bit like the rabbit in the headlights really when it comes to actually what they do to stand up and fight back about it. So I think these are things that are going to be things we're going to have to keep taking on, because you see, when it comes to the fight against austerity, it is very clear following the election that there is much more of a mood to fight. You saw it at the local, at the rally, opening rally of Marxism last night, the sense of now or never for people to fight back, to defend the welfare state and defend public services, I think is something in which also it means it starts to open the door for us to be able to think, how do we get to all of those trade unionists who want to stand up and fight back, how do we equip them and arm them with the facts and figures they need to fight back against UKIP? Actually having some of those anti-UKIP fact sheets going out, you imagine sending them out to actually the numbers of the members of different trade union branches locally, actually that can start to have a real impact in terms of taking the argument on about what UKIP are about. I think the other thing as well is that it's interesting, and this is the reason why I think it's about a principal position as well, is that, you know, Wayman talked about Enoch Powell, who is actually Farage's hero. In fact, they called on Powell's support, actually, in one of their first elections they stood on, where they did miserably, actually. But you know, it's interesting when Wayman talks about Enoch Powell, because when he made the Rivers of Blood speech, he was sacked as a shadow cabinet member for the Tory party. And interestingly, when I heard Ken Livingston speak at the UAF conference this year, he talked about being on Lambeth Council with John Major, where they sacked about 9 Tory councillors for being racist as well. That terrain has gone. Yeah, that middle ground has shifted dramatically. So we are operating in a much more open space in which a whole number of givens are no longer there. And partly I think it means that actually we have to really build our bases. And I think people have been in a whole number of areas very successful at doing this, but we have to build on it. We have to really fight, I think, to pull people from the local Labour parties, from the trade union groups, the community groups, tenants groups, disability groups, anti-racist. We have to pull those people together in a coalition to stand up against UKIP and really start to challenge them. And the evidence is that wherever we do that, we have an impact on them and we can push them back. And I just think, you know, over the next 5 years, you know, we have a fight to take on against austerity, but we also have a massive fight against racism. And taking on UKIP is a key part of that fight against racism. Actually forming a united front around the Stand Up to UKIP campaign can be an essential tool, I think, in the hands of people that are looking to stand up to a ruling class who is absolutely intent on driving through for us to pay for their crisis, and racism is a key tool in their hands to do that. We have to locate UKIP as a part of that drive to make us pay. That's going to be an essential part for us in terms of fighting back against them over the coming years.